This is Janet Mefford Today.
Our confidence is in Christ alone.
Are we going to stand with God, come what may?
If the Word of God says it, I believe it.
And that's the way it is.
And now, here is Janet Mefford.
Thank you so much for joining us. We are hearing more and more these days about artificial intelligence and its possibilities for the future. In fact, the Huffington Post recently reported automation has already far exceeded the physical capabilities of humans, and now artificial intelligence is on the brink of surpassing our mental capacity. Another site asks, can artificial intelligence help create world peace? And some are even saying that supercomputers will one day achieve human-like capabilities like emotions. Dr. Stephen Hawking actually said AI could spell the end of the human race. But is there truth to all of this? So we're going to get some answers today from Dr. Robert Marks, Distinguished Professor of Electrical and Computer Engineering at Baylor University and Senior Research Scientist at the Evolutionary Informatics Lab. He's also been Faculty Advisor for CRU, formerly Campus Crusade for Christ at the University of Washington for 17 years, and is the co-author of Introduction to Evolutionary Informatics. Dr. Marks, it's so great to have you here. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Janet. It's an honor to be asked.
Well, it's great to have you here. This is not my forte. I am no expert on this, so I'm delighted you're here. So tell us a little bit about artificial intelligence. People know about some of the progress we've made technologically, but what differentiates AI from previous technology?
Well, the fact is that not very much. Artificial intelligence has been around for many, many years. Back in the 1960s, there were people at Stanford which were training artificial neural networks to forecast the weather, to play chess, and to play blackjack. And today we see artificial intelligence doing a lot more exciting things, like beating world champions at Go.
Yes.
But the actual intelligence, if you will, of the computer has not increased. Rather, the computers have gotten faster and they have more memory, and that's about it.
That's interesting when you say intelligence has not increased. How would you even measure whether or not the computer itself is intelligent? It's kind of interesting.
Well, excellent question. The guy that invented the computer was Alan Turing. Now, he was in a movie called The Imitation Game, and he's famous for cracking the Nazi Enigma code.
Oh, yeah?
And he was also the father of modern computer science. And he decided that he wanted to see if computers could replace man. In fact, that's the meaning of the term imitation game. He wanted to see if he could invent a machine that could imitate man. And he came up with this little thing called a Turing machine back in the 1930s that had kind of a tape on it, and you could program it and watch it respond and things like that. And today's computers can't do more than Turing's machine did. Now, Turing's machine would maybe take 1,000 or 1,000,000 years, but today's machines can do it much faster. But this is something which is taught to undergraduate computer science students. It's something called the Church-Turing thesis. So computers, if we want to know their limitations, we can go back and actually look at Turing's original machine, look at its limitations, and that's the limitations of the computers that we have today.
That is fascinating. What are the limitations then? When we hear all this hype from people like Bill Gates and people like Stephen Hawking, they're afraid that the technological advancements are getting to the point where if it fell into the wrong hands, they could wipe out humanity. I mean, what do you make of all of that?
Well, you know, this is an old story. Nobel, for example, who created dynamite, was afraid that he had destroyed the world and started the Nobel Prize in order to spread peace. So there's been lots of these prophets of gloom and doom for quite some time, and I'm sure we could talk about those individually. But no, the computer is going to make an incredible impact on our society. My goodness, 25 years ago, you would not have heard of terms such as webmaster, data scientists, or bloggers. These are new things which have been introduced by the introduction of computers. And certainly computers are going to be able to take over a lot of the things we do. But as far as becoming creative, of being sentient, no, the computer, I think, is never going to do that. And I think there's a lot of growing support for that inability of the computer to do that. The artificial intelligence that you see in places like the Terminator movie or the Matrix, where the computer became self-aware and gained consciousness and took over the world, that'll never happen. computers can be bad in the future, but if they're going to be bad in the future, it's because there's some programmer somewhere that has trained them to do that or has been very careless in their programming.
Now, why, it's so fascinating. Why is it then that you have people of this caliber, Bill Gates, Microsoft, and a lot of people respect him, and Stephen Hawking, brilliant physicist and so forth. If they're saying it, a lot of people think, then we should be concerned because they're not just rank and file people who have certain opinions. Is there a potential or is there a wall that would prevent ever being able to get to the point where machines could outsmart humans? Is that just something that can't be breached?
Well, you have to define what you mean by outsmart. If you look at a big database like Watson beating the people at Jeopardy, he had access to the Watson. I'm referring to him at the, with the male pronoun.
It's but okay.
Watson had access to an incredible amount of data and could recall it very, very quickly. And if you call that thinking, well, yeah, you know, Watson is going to be better. But here's some things that the computer will never be able to do. It will never be able to create. I first came along this train of thought by reading the work of Roger Penrose. Now, there might not be a lot of resonance with the name Roger Penrose, but he actually published the Penrose-Hawking theory of singularities for black holes.
Oh, yeah.
So that gives him some sort of credibility. And in my field, he's just an incredible mathematician. But he actually pointed out to the creative ability of people as an example of something that could be done by the human being that can't be done by the computer.
Hmm.
And so, no, there will never be creation. There's a great illustration, if I may, called Searle's Chinese Room, that illustrates that basically computers only do what they're told. They can't think, they can't understand, they have to follow what's called algorithms.
Right.
Algorithms are like recipes. They're step-by-step procedures to do something. And that's all that a computer can do. Now, Hawking, going back to some very wonderful mathematics, actually showed that, yes, there were limitations to what algorithms could do. And many things are non-algorithmic, meaning they're non-computable.
Yeah.
And there are things you can prove in computer science. You can prove, for example, one computer program is unable to analyze another computer program for many properties. This analysis is impossible, and no, it isn't conjecture. It's actually a mathematical certainty. And then Penrose went along and said, well, you know, this is true also of creativity. And he began to explore the human creativity that we experience throughout the ages. And this is something which is above and beyond the capability of a computer. But Searle's Chinese Room, let me say that and then
sure.
I'll listen for questions. Searle's Chinese Room was an example of what computers can do. There's a little agent in a room, and the job of this agent is to translate, let's say, English into Chinese. I'm going to butcher the original presentation of the Chinese Room. But here's the idea. Somebody slips a little paper in with some phrase or word in Chinese, and the agent inside takes a look at this piece of paper, and he goes over and looks at a great big hallway of file cabinets. I think people still know what file cabinets are. And so he looks in the file cabinets until he finds this word, and he finds the matching word,
right,
or matching phrase. And then he copies down the matching phrase. He takes it over to the slit and then slips it out. Now, from the outside, it might look like that computer, that little Chinese room, knew English and knew Chinese. That little guy inside, which is following an algorithm, has no idea what English means, has no idea what Chinese means, has no understanding of the Chinese language or how to translate it except within the algorithm that it's been programmed to do to look up the translation.
Wow.
So that's all a computer can do, just what it's told.
And that makes a lot of sense. I like that picture there, because what you're really saying is that you are, through an algorithm, you're able to get a computer to do a certain task, but it doesn't give that computer any sense of human emotion or any human characteristics just because he's programmed that way.
You can try to fool people into thinking this, and this is one of the problems on this hype curve that we're on for artificial intelligence. I think a lot of the people that are promoting the future and the excitement of AI are overselling it, and they use the seductive semantics and seductive optics where they actually put the artificial intelligence in a human-like robot, and people will look at that and they will say, oh my goodness, yeah, it does look human, when actually the artificial intelligence has nothing to do with the nothing to do with the actual robotic form.
Fantastic. We're going to come back. Dr. Robert Marks, my guest, will come back talking about artificial intelligence and its limitations. Stay with us on Janet Mefford Today.
Here is today's Capitol Hill Brief with Concerned Women for America President Penny Nance.
I have some hard news. 37% of women obtaining abortions identified as evangelical or Catholic. Though self-identification may be a poor form of measuring religious engagement, these findings show that women getting an abortion are willing to be thought of as religious, but are still willing to get an abortion. This is a tragic failure of the church to truly educate women on what it means to trust God's providence and forgiveness in difficult circumstances. What can we do to help our churches teach pro-life values and support girls who get pregnant? I think this is a fundamental question that every Christian church has to face, and I hope you will take it in prayer today.
Join us on the front lines. Fight to defend critical issues like the sanctity of life through prayer and action. Together, we'll bring biblical, constitutional values back to our nation. Visit CapitolHillBrief.org to give today. That's CapitolHillBrief.org.
What or who is controlling your mood right now? Is it a spouse, a family member, a coworker? Is it a situation you're facing, or even the news? This is Jeannie Nigo with Unshaken. Whoever or whatever is determining how you feel right now, what you say or what you do has become your God. You've put them on the throne of your life and taken God off. It's impossible to experience intimacy with God with these false idols controlling your life. Make it a habit to ask God throughout the day to show you what's determining your mood at that moment. If it's anything other than who God is or how He sees you, confess it as sin and put God back on the throne. Only then will you be able to stand strong in intimacy with Him. For more on how to remain unshaken in a world that's all shook up, go to jeannienigro.com. That's JeannieNigro.com. That's JeannieNigro.com.
Hi, I'm John Erickson Tata, and I love Hebrews chapter 4 where it says, "Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." Don't you love that? We approach God's throne with confidence, but not to first find help for all our needs. No. We approach the throne to first receive mercy. And that's such an important lesson because we often come to God as though He were our personal butler, only there to meet our needs. We even pray as though we were dropping coins in a vending machine, pull the right levers, say the right things, and you've got answers from God. Well, I don't think so. A throne of grace is first a place to receive mercy, saying, "Oh God, how I have sinned." Only after such a confession are our needs met. Something to remember as you approach God today.
We are back on Janet Mefford Today. A fascinating discussion. Dr. Robert Marks is joining us, distinguished professor of electrical and computer engineering at Baylor University, my alma mater. And I'm so excited he's here to kind of debunk some of these claims about artificial intelligence and the great threats to the end of the human race and all the rest that we hear from some of these big names. We'll talk a little bit, Dr. Marks, if you would, about this exciting part of AI, where it's taking us right now. You have all of these special things that these computers can do now, these supercomputers and beating people in chess, but also things like, you know, languages and things like that. Talk a little bit about where it is right now and some of the exciting things that are happening.
Well, artificial intelligence is going to do very well at winning board games. we see it beating people at tic-tac-toe and checkers and chess, and now with the most difficult game of all time, Go. But there again, it's a matter of the amount of analysis it can do. All these board games have certain contingencies for a given set where the board is at right now, and a computer can explore all these contingencies really quickly, and a human being has to juggle them all in their mind, and they aren't able to do as much. So, yeah, they're going to be doing great in board games. Driverless cars, I don't know. I hear a lot of talk about them, but I don't see them introduced the way they were hyped a year or so ago, so we're waiting on that. AI, it depends how you define artificial intelligence, but that's used in your computer in your spam filter that decides where your email goes, whether it's whether it goes in your spam filter or whether it allows you to look at it. Targeted sales, I think, is another one. If you've done anything on Amazon.com, they do something called data mining, where they look at all the data associated with you and everything related to you and try to sell you stuff. Google Home and, oh gosh, what's the Amazon one?
Alexa, yeah.
Yeah, you know, that we bought a Google Home, and it's just mind-blowing. It's just incredible what it's able to do. One that I'm kind of excited about right now is something called business intelligence. Now, the computer cannot create anything, but they can arrange data in a visual manner so that people can look at it and see creative things in the patterns that they're presented. And that's an area called business intelligence. So those are some of the exciting things. I think that if you think about the future, anything that you can imagine writing an algorithm for, that you can write a step-by-step procedure for, the computer might be able to replace it. I mean, it's already replaced travel agents, hasn't it?
Yes, absolutely.
And I think it'll probably replace, you know, fast food sort of thing, employment. But hey, that happens all the time with the introduction of new technology.
True. Now, this is kind of interesting. You were talking about self-driving cars, and Elon Musk would be a person who, you know, he's developing that. What about, now he's got this new company, from what I've read, that is going to look into ways to link human brains to computers. And then you get into sort of this discussion about technocracy and where that's taking us. What can you say about that whole movement of linking brains to computers and having technology that would, you know, really revolutionize the way we live in different ways?
Very good question. I think that Ray Kurzweil is also a big proponent of that sort of thing.
Yes.
In my understanding, I don't think the human brain will ever be able to be downloaded into a computer because of its capabilities above and beyond that of a computer. Will a computer be able to augment human performance by linking the human brain to it? Absolutely. Right now, we are linked to computers. Our brains are linked to computers by our keyboards. And the only difference is going to be that instead of going through the keyboards, or now with Google Home or Alexa through audio sort of transmissions, there might be some sort of hard wiring. So that seems a little bit scary, but I don't think it's a big extrapolation of what we have now.
That's interesting. Well, and then also you've been hearing some things in the news lately about the potential capability of being able to read our minds, that computers could read our minds. And that freaks people out. They say, well, I don't want a computer to read my mind. I want my thoughts to be by myself. Is that ever really something that a computer could accomplish, though?
Well, you know, that's a very interesting question, and it has more to do with a neurosurgeon or a neuroscience person. I don't know. I do know that the brain creates a lot of interesting waveforms, and the question is, can you take those waveforms and can you translate it in thoughts? I can actually see something like that happening, yes.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah,
a little bit scary.
But the point is there is that you do have these signals up in your brain, and those signals correspond to something, and the only question is how you might take those signals and, you know, decodify them.
I guess. Boy, that's neat. Well, one of the things I also read recently was about the fact that your next doctor could be a bot. And this is now something that AI may be coming and moving into healthcare and being able to make a difference in healthcare. Do you see that as a problem at all, that you're taking, you know, the human experience out of healthcare more and more, and you're seeing more technological, you know, using a bot in healthcare? Do you see any problem with that at all, or do you think that that's a benefit?
Well, I think it's like any new technology. I think it's probably best used as a tool. And yes, I think that a human being probably has to make the final call. I had a friend in the 1990s, Russ Eberhardt, from Johns Hopkins University, that wrote a neural network that trained a neural network to diagnose diseases, give it symptoms, it would give a disease. And it actually outperformed a lot of the physicians at the time.
Oh, wow.
But there was a lot of pushback because the physicians, who are not known for their small egos, didn't want to be replaced by automation. Sure. But I think that as as physicians become more and more aware of the capabilities of artificial intelligence, that they're going to use it. I'll give you another story, which is very interesting. The number of papers which are published on, for example, Medline in biomedics, right. if you were to stack them, I actually did a calculation last year, the number of papers and journals would exceed the height of the Empire State Building.
Okay? Oh.
So there, even in my field, there's like 200 papers published today. It's ridiculous. So when physicians go in for a specific strain sort of case, they don't have the time, the effort to read all of the literature. So they do have AI tools now, which are used in practice to go scour the literature and to look, bring up pertinent papers that are relevant to the disease at hand. I thought that was a great application of artificial intelligence.
Definitely.
It certainly didn't replace the physician, but it certainly augmented their power.
That would make a lot of sense. What about the far-fetched claims about robots eventually being able to turn on us and kill us, and you know, seeing robots used in warfare situations and things like this? Do you have any particular concerns about that aspect of technology?
Well, I do think that technology drives warfare, and I think a lot of the superiority of the United States in military is because of technology. It's won a lot of wars, and it's kept us at the forefront. And I do believe that artificial intelligence will be used in war. Certainly, as far as turning on us, I think that artificial intelligence is a powerful tool. And if you misuse that powerful tool, you're going to get problems. We have today viruses on our computers. You probably remember the virus that was downloaded by the United States into the Iranian uranium refiner that crashed its refiner. That was a malware that was used in a military, pseudo-military sort of application. So, yeah, it is going to be used. But artificial intelligence, again, because it comes from a computer, it will never be sentient, it will never be creative, and it will never have any understanding of what it's doing. It will be doing what it's told to do.
Yeah. Now, I'm interested in your perspective, from a Christian perspective. We seem to have a lot of issues these days with defining humanity and what does it mean to be a human being and can you create your own reality? And a lot of streams are coming into this whole experience. But what are your thoughts on AI as it pertains to our view of ourselves as human beings?
Well, this is interesting, and it gets back to Roger Penrose's idea that we are above and beyond a computer. Now, if we are above and beyond a computer, where does that superiority come from? Where does that creativity come from? Now, currently in science, it's an open question. Roger Penrose, who is agnostic atheist, is looking at something called quantum tubules in the human brain as the source of the creativity. From a Christian perspective, I kind of like the idea that our intelligence does come from an intelligent designer above and beyond us. And in fact, anything that has ever been creative in the history of the universe has come from intelligence, be it the intelligence of the human being or the intelligence of the creator. So intelligence is something special. It's something which is godlike that allows all of these things to happen. And again, this right now is an ideology because science is still looking at this idea of these quantum tubules. And I tell you, if they ever discover these quantum tubules and they do come up with, if they're right, they come up with a computer that uses these quantum tubules that is above and beyond the Turing machine, we do have problems. All of the hype and the fear that people experience today are going to be warranted. But we are so far from that. And I think it might be one of these things that kind of lives on and is never proven.
Goodness, that's really something to keep an eye on. In the meantime, how would you advise us to trash the hype? In other words, those who are saying, oh, what we have right now, it could change the world and extinguish the human race. How should we respond to that?
Well, everybody should have what they call a hype filter. And I think this is not only good for AI, but just about anything. Number one is forecasting. There was a great quantum physicist, Niels Bohr, who said, predicting the future is dangerous. No, forecasting is dangerous, especially if it's about the future. That was his statement. Okay. So it's true. Anytime you forecast, you have a great chance of being incorrect. So I read a recent article in New Scientist where they talked about in the year 2060, computers would do anything. Well, that's baloney. If you look back at forecasts in the past, you find out that even with well-intentioned scientists, that they were often wrong. I mean, Einstein said God doesn't play dice with the universe, and just last year it was proved indisputably by proof of something called Bell's theorem that Einstein was wrong. Not only does God play dice, but information and creativity in the terms of bits is introduced into our universe all the time. So we have to watch out that and some other things also for the hype filter, but I hear the music in the background.
Yeah, it's time to go. It went too fast, but Dr. Robert Marks, thank you so much for being with us. It was great to have you.
Okay, Janet, thank you very much.
All right.
Enjoyed it.
God bless you. Thank you again. We'll be back on Janet Mefford Today.
Welcome to Bible Q&A with John MacArthur. Well, John, a common question flows out of the book of James. In chapter 2 and verse 21, it says, "Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered up Isaac, his son, on the altar?" Then a couple of verses later, James writes that a man is justified by works and not by faith alone. Well, that could easily be read as an argument for a works-based salvation, couldn't it? We believe in God, we do good things, He saves us. How do you interpret it?
Great question, Denny, and I know many people have this question. Is James in conflict with the rest of Scripture? Of course, even the Old Testament, Habakkuk says the just shall live by faith, and that's repeated numerous times and delineated and carefully argued in the New Testament. Salvation is by grace alone. It is by faith and not of works, according to Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. So what in the world is James saying when he says Abraham, our father, was justified by works? The answer to that is simply this, that while justification before God was not by works, being righteous before God was not by works, being deemed righteous by men was by works. In other words, show me your works and I'll believe in your faith. And that's what James says. Your true salvation by faith is demonstrated in your works. That's why Paul says in Philippians, work out your salvation. God has worked it in and you work it out. So when we look at Abraham and see him willing to offer up his son as an act of obedience, we know God had transformed his heart.
All right. Thanks, John. This is Bible Q&A with John MacArthur. John's the author of the MacArthur New Testament Commentary Series. For more in-depth teaching, visit MacArthurCommentaries.com.
This is Anne Graham Lotz with Daily Light for Daily Living. Human love will most certainly let you down sooner or later, to a greater or lesser degree. Even the love of a best friend, a child, a spouse can grow cold. But in Jeremiah 31:3, God declares, "I have loved you with an everlasting love. The plan to reconcile us to Himself, to forgive us of all of our sins, is a plan that originated in the heart of God. It's a plan motivated by His great love. And one thing you can know for sure is God loves you." Romans 8:38 to 39 says, "For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Listen to me. Nothing can separate you from God's love. How do I know? He says so. This is Ann Graham Lotz.
Ministry never occurs in isolation. It happens when we join our brothers and sisters in Christ in a mission to the world. This is Jim Garlow. We minister as members of something much greater than ourselves. When the early church sent a person on a ministry, he or she went with the support of all who were part of the church. In his prayer in John 17, Jesus says that he had been sent by God, the Father, into the world. In a similar way, Jesus sent his followers into ministry. Jesus said to the Father in John 17, 18, "I sent them into the world just as you sent me into the world." Being sent into ministry means being called, gifted, and trained as laypersons on a divine mission with a specific task. And as we do this task, we function as representatives of the sending party, the church. There's more at jimgarlow.com.
For Cruise City's Ben Goldsmith, prayer has been vital in seeing transformation happen. Hi, I'm Steve Douglas for Making Your Life Count. And Ben tells us how God has been using his friend Tom as he prayer walks the streets of his city.
He was walking with a friend, and as they got down the street, they heard a gentleman yelling to them, "Hey, hey, wait, wait, are you guys praying?" They were a little surprised that he knew that, but they said, "Yes." And he says, "I need for you to pray for me. My car is dead and I need to get another car. Would you pray for me that I could find a car that I could afford?" So they did. And it began to start a relationship with that family. In the process, Donnie prayed to receive Christ. But it all started with simply prayer walking the street.
Now that is encouraging. There's no telling just how you might see God working through prayer in your neighborhood.
Back on Janet Mefford Today. Well, Senate Republicans reportedly are preparing to vote on Obamacare's repeal next week, but Politico says the timeline could blow up because there's no final deal yet on any of the sticking points and negotiations are still really fluid. 50 Republicans, as we know, are needed to pass the bill with Mike Pence, the vice president, as tiebreaker. And one of the continuing issues is whether or not McConnell will cut Planned Parenthood's defunding in order to secure the votes he needs. The life issue has become an extremely fractious sticking point for Obamacare overall, with Christians and other pro-lifers saying that our taxpayer money should not be used to pay for abortion-causing drugs or abortion itself. Is there a way, though, to get your medical bills covered and not have to compromise on the life issue? Well, we're going to tackle that today with Dale Bellis, Executive Director of Liberty HealthShare, a national nonprofit healthcare sharing ministry. So great to welcome you back, Dale. How are you?
Thank you, Janet. It is always a pleasure to be with you, and it's a joy to be here.
Well, what do you make of pro-lifers' concerns about potentially having to continue funding Planned Parenthood under the new Obamacare repeal? This is a real attack on conscience, they're fearing.
It really is. In fact, we have joined together with conscience groups across the nation to really appeal to Congress at this particular stage to give awareness and notice that this is a deeply fractious issue.
Yeah.
And that we as believers who hold deeply held beliefs do not want our dollars to be used in health care to support that progressive agenda, particularly abortion. But gratefully, under the terms of the existing regulation, the ACA, there is a safe harbor for people of faith and values to join in with other folks of like mind through healthcare sharing and Liberty HealthShare particularly, to make sure that their money is not used in ways that would violate their closely held beliefs.
Which is wonderful. And we've been so excited to be telling people about Liberty HealthShare as a great option, really, for covering your medical bills without compromising your pro-life values. Explain why it is that you don't have to compromise on your pro-life values if you're going with Liberty HealthShare.
Because, number one, we are not insurance, and so we're not subject to the requirements and mandates of the Affordable Care Act. And we decide among and between ourselves as health sharing members as to the way in which we want our dollars to be used. And so our members decide what will be a part of our sharing guidelines, and almost unanimously to a family, we have all agreed we do not want our money being used to support the costs of abortion or abortive fashions or, frankly, other procedures that are supportive of high-risk lifestyles.
Very good. Now, tell us a little bit about this Obamacare repeal, because some people may be saying, are you still going to be exempt? Are you still going to be able to do what you do under the repeal? Or how do things work right now in terms of what the Republicans are trying to do?
Well, we are, in fact, talking to our legislators on Capitol Hill about health care sharing and the importance of them continuing this tradition of meeting health care costs unrelated to insurance and among and between people of faith. And we're asking basically for three things. Number one, continue for any new mandates that you may come across in this new legislation. Just extend the existing exemption that is currently in the Affordable Care Act to any new legislation that comes through. Number two is we would love to enjoy the option or choice of health savings accounts. We believe that's a useful consumer tool for self-pay patients participating in healthcare sharing. And so as they are, in fact, considering HSA expansions, include members of healthcare sharing ministries, both issues there has been wide acceptance and responsiveness, and we're grateful for that and anticipate that they will incorporate and accommodate those two concerns.
Very good. That's interesting. Now, healthcare savings accounts, that's one thing that people will enjoy, for example, as a benefit at work. You're able to put aside money and save the taxes on that. So basically, are you seeking then to be able to do it exactly the same way, except people who are using healthcare sharing ministries rather than insurance would be able to enjoy the tax benefits then as well as people who are on insurance?
Enjoy the tax benefits, but decouple it from the insurance requirement. We are not insurance, don't want to be. We are on a totally different mindset or methodology for meeting healthcare costs, mutual assistance, mutual aid, voluntary commitment to one another. We're not insurance. It's just decoupling HSA option from the requirement to have insurance by one of two methods. The first one we favor, and we'll take the second one. The first one is to make that available to all Americans. Across the board HSA option, whether you have insurance or not, just give that opportunity to everyone, or simply name healthcare sharing ministry members as eligible.
Well, that's great. I'll be anxious to see where that goes. You know, one of the things that we talked about just at the outset here, Dale, was about conscience and why healthcare sharing ministries are so great. Liberty HealthShare does such a great job for its members in terms of protecting conscience. But financially, why would you say that Liberty HealthShare makes sense?
Well, number one, it's our money at stake. And so that just changes the consumer attitude and perspective. If it's my pockets, and in this case, also the pockets of my fellow members, there's a sense of awareness about cost.
Yeah.
We're not, as the third-party pay system is currently structured in America, it's somebody else's money paying for that health care, so I'm insulated from those cost choices and decisions. Here, it's my money at stake. So while I'm at that counter, I'm reviewing the cost, evaluating the treatment plan, eliminating unnecessary care. And so that's the first major gate through which the cost efficiency occurs. The second is that we are all, because we believe our bodies are temples and ought to be taken care of, and we're stewards before God for our bodies, we're all health conscious.
Right.
That ripples down into cost efficiency. I'm going to take steps that are preventative and be sure I live a life that's supportive of health.
That's great.
The third is we access deep, deep discounts in the marketplace. Few people realize that what a hospital or a doctor bills is not what they will receive to settle that particular pay or that particular service in full.
Right.
And so those three legs of that stool all work together for a very cost-efficient way to meet healthcare costs.
What would you say, Dale, is one of the biggest concerns people have about changing the way in which they pay their medical bills and transitioning from insurance into healthcare sharing ministries like Liberty HealthShare? What do people tend to be nervous about, and how do you assuage those fears?
Excellent question, because it is a mindset change. We are not depending upon a contract of indemnity where we are pooling the money and paying for an occurrence under the terms of a contract that we've made a promise to pay. We don't promise to pay nor transfer risk. We're not insurance.
Right.
We're a voluntary sharing ministry. And so we simply turn our conviction that God has placed us here on earth to assist another person whenever they're in need. That very mentality or orientation or conviction is then turned to a solution for healthcare. We're voluntary, we're cooperative, but it's based upon our closely held convictions that God's placed us here on earth to be engaged with others who have needs.
Good.
That's the biggest mindset change. And for those who are most comfortable with the guarantee of an insurance contract, they feel uncomfortable about this method. but the tens of thousands of us that made that switch wouldn't do it any other way.
Very good. Very good. And as we always say, Dale, from time to time when we talk about this, you don't have to worry about which doctor you go to or which hospital, because that whole thing of in-network and out-network is now not part of the equation. For a lot of people, that's a huge advantage.
Yeah, we do not have a network. We're all self-pay patients. So either we deal with that provider on a self-pay basis and submit that receipt for sharing, or they use our billing process and send the bill to Liberty HealthShare. We process it, and it shows up in that individual's online account. We call it a share box. So either way, we are in the driver's seat as to what doctor or what hospital we access.
Very good. Well, check them out, libertyhealthshare.org. Dale Bellis with us. So good to talk to you again, Dale. Have a great day.
Janet, God bless. Thank you for the time to be with you.
God bless you. And we'll be back on Janet Mefford Today.
Sometimes life takes twists and turns that you just weren't expecting. This is Jeannie Nigro with Unshaken. Perhaps you find yourself alone after years of marriage, or suddenly unemployed, in financial crisis, or perhaps your kids are following the ways of the world. When we experience the unexpected in our lives, we may end up wondering, how did we ever get to this place? How did things end up this way? However, in the midst of life's shakiest circumstances, God is calling you to remain unshaken. How is this possible? By accepting that the only thing that can't change is who God is and how He sees you. When you hold on to this truth and focus on what can't change, then you will be able to stand strong and unshaken no matter what twists and turns are tossed your way. For more on how to remain unshaken in a world that's all shook up, go to jeannienigro.com. That's JeanneNigro.com. That's jeannienigro.com.
Noah's daughters-in-law. This is Ken Ham, encouraging the church to start all our thinking with God's Word. All humans can be traced back to three major genetic groups. Now, these groups are Noah's daughters-in-law. Now, all of us are ultimately descended from one woman, Eve. But 10 generations after her, the global flood reduced the population to just 8 people. And since then, there have been about 400 generations. Now, if this history recorded in Genesis is true, we'd expect to find few genetic differences between Noah's daughters-in-law. Since there weren't many generations before the flood, there wasn't time in the world before the flood for mutations to stack up, and this is exactly what we see. These three women had only a few genetic differences. It confirms God's word.
Sign up for free daily email insights from Ken Ham when you visit our faith-building website at AnswersRadio.com. There are many more answers at AnswersRadio.com.
For your walk with Jesus, this is David Wolin with Haven Ministries and a thought from God's Word taken from Anchor Devotional. What's the opposite of faith? Is it doubt? Well, maybe, but I think it goes deeper than that. If you listen carefully to the words of Jesus, you'll see there's something else present in the heart of someone who's lost their faith. In Mark chapter 4, the disciples were in a boat with Jesus, far away from shore, when a great storm came upon them. They were terrified until Jesus rebuked the storm, and it became calm. And then Jesus said to them, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" You see, without faith, what we're left with is fear. But our fear can give way to faith if we behold the one who calms the storm with just a word. You can get your Anchor devotional delivered in print monthly at getanchor.com.
We are back on Janet Mefford Today. You know, who says prayer doesn't change things? This is just incredible. I was doing this pre-recorded interview yesterday with Troy Newman, my friend from Operation Rescue, where he serves as president. And of course, he's the genius who is part of the Center for Medical Progress that has planned all of these wonderfully evil but good in their journalistic endeavor undercover videos of Planned Parenthood executives that David DeLeiden has revealed to the world and all these great pro-lifers, Sandra Merritt. And as you know, David DeLeiden and Sandra Merritt have had a lot of legal action brought against them. One example was back in 2016 when David Dalyden and Sandra Merritt were indicted by a tainted grand jury, as Troy said, on similar charges to the ones they're facing now, which were later dismissed after evidence surfaced that the Harris County District Attorney's Office colluded with Planned Parenthood for political reasons to turn the grand jury against them. So those were thrown out. Now, their latest charges have also been thrown out. This is so fantastic. And I had told Troy yesterday, we're going to be praying for you, Troy. And I promise I'll be praying for you that the Lord vindicates you, because these are crazy charges. He's also party to the lawsuit. And it is the case now that these 15 felony counts related to secret recordings that these pro-lifers made providing evidence of Planned Parenthood's participation in the illegal trafficking of aborted baby remains are not standing. In fact, Life News calls it a huge victory. A California court yesterday dismissed almost all of these criminal charges filed against David Dalyden and Sandra Merritt. And it's just such a great, great day. It's just so wonderful. The California Attorney General Javier Becerra filed these 15 felony charges against both David and Sandra. Becerra is a longtime abortion advocate with financial connections to the Planned Parenthood abortion company that the two pro-life advocates exposed in the videos for selling body parts such as babies' brains and livers. Ugh, makes me sick every time I have to even confront this. At the time, pro-life advocates said Becerra's 15 felony charges were bogus, and they were meant to belittle the expose campaign and to cast aspersions on Dalyden and the organization behind the videos, which is the Center for Medical Progress. They said the attempt was about drawing attention away from Planned Parenthood's sales of aborted baby parts. Well, it was. So the San Francisco Superior Court on Wednesday dismissed 14 out of the 15 criminal counts. The pair is still charged with one count of conspiracy to invade privacy. However, the court dismissed the charges with leave to amend, meaning Becerra could refile the charges with additional supposed evidence against the pair. The court ruled that counts 1 through 14 were legally insufficient. The state has the opportunity to amend if it can plead a more legally sufficient and specific complaint. The California Attorney General filed these criminal counts against Merritt with counts 1 through 14 for each of the alleged interviews and count 15 for an alleged conspiracy. San Francisco County Superior Court Judge Christopher Height gave the state attorney general's office until mid-July to file a revised complaint. So now we have to change what we're praying for and pray that this last count will be dropped and that a new complaint will not be filed. Come on, church, let's get at it. In a statement to Life News, Matt Staver, the pro-life attorney from Liberty Counsel representing Sandra Merritt, said this is a huge victory to have 14 criminal counts dismissed, and we will now turn our attention to dismissing the final count. The complaint by the California Attorney General is unprecedented and, frankly, will threaten every journalist who provides valuable information to the public. This final count will also fall. Liberty Counsel argued that the criminal complaint for illegally recording supposedly private conversations in restaurants, hotel lobbies, and other public places was legally deficient for a lot of reasons, and not the least of which was the Attorney General's decision to prosecute Merritt in secret proceedings without identifying even the names of her accusers or purported victims. The complaint did not provide Merritt with the minimum notice required by the Constitution and California law as to what she supposedly did wrong so that she can mount a proper and vigorous defense. The complaint was also vague and full of inconsistencies. This is just great. Today's decision, meaning yesterday, by the San Francisco Superior Court seems to lend additional credence to the fact that abortion advocates and their pro-abortion friends in politics are filing the charges for political rather than substantive reasons. Well, we all knew that. We all knew that all along, but this is just fantastic that these charges were dismissed. And it was so much worse than that. You know, we talk about what happened with this issue of these counts not even standing and not even being reasonable. I mean, one of the things Troy said yesterday was the fact that, in fact, these filmings took place in public places. It wasn't like they walked into somebody's private house and went in their bedroom and filmed them as they were having a conversation or their kitchen or something like that. It was a public place. And additionally, it's also been noted that under this statute, California law allows for you to actually conduct secret recordings if you are convinced that a felony is being committed or a potential felony is being committed. And it has been argued previously that this is why it was fine for them to do it. It wasn't just fine for them to do it. It was heroic for them to do it. And they're not going after who they need to be going after, which is Planned Parenthood. We have all the evidence that we need when we look at all those videos. What is it, about 14 now? 14 videos? I don't know. There might be a few extra ones we're not counting as far as the charges here that were leveled against David Dalyden and Sandra Merritt. But in any event, all we need to do is look at those videos and we can see exactly what these evil people are up to. Illegally trafficking body parts. And this was what all of this was about. This was why we had the Senate Judiciary Committee and all these hearings on whether or not they actually violated the law. And, let's go after the people who actually are breaking the law and doing something horrific. You don't go after the people who are the whistleblowers and the people who are doing the valiant thing and the moral thing and the upstanding thing, which is exposing evil and putting them through such horrible circumstances in order to do the right thing, to punish them. This is the power of Planned Parenthood. And Kamala Harris, one of the things Troy has pointed out is that Kamala Harris's chief of staff just happens to be Cecile Richards' daughter, for crying out loud. There's so much here. Not only that, but there also has been this issue regarding the judge, Judge Orrick, and Judge Orrick, who is overseeing the case, and they were pointing out that there are things about his ties to Planned Parenthood that weren't previously fully disclosed. And so they've been seeking to get that federal judge kicked off the case. It's a mess because everywhere you turn, it's corruption, 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 corruption. So this is just fantastic. I'm so happy to see this. It's such a wonderful answer to prayer. And I just pray that they're not going to have to face additional charges. They shouldn't be facing additional charges. They should be hailed and they should be given the Presidential Medal of Honor, as far as I'm concerned. They're heroes. That's all there is to it. Troy's a hero. David's a hero. Sandra's a hero. Everybody who was involved in the effort to expose the evil, they're heroes. And you know they're heroes because of how the enemy is reacting. The degree to which these leftist politicians are trying to just crush them is despicable. These people shouldn't even be in public office. They are using the law as a bludgeon to get back at their enemies because there is, and Troy has said this on many occasions before. Whenever I've talked to him, he said, when you see more and more and more and more evil out of the pro-abortion side, it just shows you that the entire thing is satanic. Think about this. Look at what happens every single day. You have people who are running clinics for the very purpose of slaughtering children. It doesn't get any lower than that. It doesn't get any lower than that. So why would we be surprised if they can do that? Truly, that involves a completely seared conscience. And as we know, there have been people involved in the abortion business who God has been very gracious to and saved out of it. And a lot of people who are now working very diligently for the pro-life side. I think of Abby Johnson. And I think of people like Bernard Nathanson, formerly of NARAL. There have been wonderful people who have been saved and have been tremendously helpful to the pro-life cause simply because they were once on the other side. But if you're doing that for a living and your conscience is that seared, then why would it surprise us that you would be able to go further down the line and do something even beyond that? Talk about eyeballs and it fell in my lap and ew, it was so gross, and crushing skulls. Like they're just, they're having lunch one day and talking about crushing baby skulls and getting intact body parts so they can sell them. I'm out of words. I really am out of words. And I'll tell you what's really depressing about it is the fact that we're in a country now where you have a substantive number of people who are not only not shocked by that, but are trying to go after the people who are bringing it to light. And it shows really the demonic realm in action. It really does. So this was a huge answer to prayer. I am thrilled to see this. But again, I would just implore you, if you've been following this case and these videos and these heroic pro-lifers for any length of time, please continue to pray for them. Please continue to pray that that last charge will be dropped, that this won't be refiled, and that, that the Trump administration and Attorney General Sessions will be able to move in and get the job done to prosecute these people who need to be prosecuted for what they've done wrong. God is in control. And we rejoice in this good victory, wonderful victory, for a man who truly is exemplary, and a woman, Sandra Merritt. Hey, thanks a lot for being with us here on Janet Mefford Today. We'll see you next time. God bless.
This week, we're learning an easy-to-remember gospel presentation. Hi, I'm John Sorensen, president of Evangelism Explosion International. Our gospel pattern is based on five main words: grace, man, God, Christ, and faith. And we're pairing each one with the finger of our hand as a learning aid. This being day four, picture your ring finger and think of the bridegroom, because today's word is Christ. Jesus Christ is both God and man. John's gospel opens with this emphasis: in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. While Jesus had many great accomplishments, there's no doubt about his most important one. He died on the cross to pay the penalty for our sin, and rose from the dead to prove he's purchased a place in heaven for us. And this gift is received by faith, and that'll be our topic tomorrow. In the meantime, visit sharelife.today to view a video demonstrating this gospel tool.